So wonderful. So yesterday, I'll just pick up the thread from what we did yesterday. Yesterday, we focused on emotional intelligence. We went through a one-hour session where we understood a few things. One, the fundamental need for emotional intelligence for leaders is something that we all agreed on. We also agreed on the fact that behaviors can change. And emotional intelligence, when we talk about emotional intelligence having four capabilities and 19 competencies, correction, four competencies and 19 capabilities, each capability is divided into behaviors. So if I say that I want to be able to manage conflict, let's say, so that's a capability. At the end of it, for me to be able to manage conflict, it needs to be translated to granular behaviors. And what we have done in this entire research that we have done, we have identified 92 granular behaviors, which come under each of these 19 capabilities. And don't get worried, none of us is going to work on 19 of those behaviors. But if I realize that conflict management is something that I need to get better at, let us say, so I can't help Rohan. Others can. I don't know what to do here. Actually, just you can help him. Okay. So what we are saying is that if I decide that I want to get better at conflict management, I will pick up a couple of behaviors, granular behaviors from there. And having picked up those granular behaviors, then identify situations where I can apply that. Because yesterday we understood one thing, that to be able to make behavioral change, there are three things that are required. Focus. Focus here is identifying conflict management is a need in me. That's the first element. Secondly, focus on identifying two granular behaviors, maybe out of four or maybe all four, that you need to work on to get better. Then you have to keep these two or three behaviors that you have identified for yourself in your attention. And as you get into situations where you can apply them, you start practicing. And every time you do that, in the brain, the first time these neurons, see, we have brain cells. Now, every time the brain cells connect to each other and keep connecting over and over again, they get hardwired. And that is where habits or behaviors get formed. So if you're trying to generate a new behavior, that sequence of neurons would not have, as of now, had a hard wiring done. So they wouldn't be wired as of now, because if they were, then you wouldn't have that challenge with that behavior. So the first time when you do it, it's going to take tremendous energy for you to be able to do it. And that's why focus, attention, and practice. So next time when you again do it, again, it will get slightly more thickened. So the more and more you do it, the more and more it gets hardwired. In fact, if you go down to the mountain sometime, you will see as you drive into the mountains on the hills around you, there will be some paths which are strongly visible and some of them which are very light and faint. The light and faint are the original behaviors that you had. And if you start going through this new route over and over again, suddenly your default behavior from the slightly visible path will become in the majorly visible path. So that's what we understood. Okay, coming to this neuro leadership program, Mahinda, welcome. Okay, he's already there. Great. So let's now go into this neuro leadership program. And let me tell you, I got interested in neuro leadership or brain science around 7 years back. When I joined Franklin Covey, there's a neuro leadership group of theirs, which I started heading in India and South Asia, which was understanding the brain in the context of coaching people. So it was brain-based coaching that I got exposed to. And in that, I suddenly realized the more and more I understood how brains function, the better I became in interacting with people, because I was able to keep that brain in a state, in an optimized state when I was interacting with that brain. Because ultimately, it was my brain interacting with my coach's brain. So I was, because I understood what the brain gets threatened by, I was able to demonstrate behavior which allowed the brain to be at peace, at rest, at calm, and thereby more open to getting into this behavioral change coaching journey. And that is where I really understood the power of it. So while Neuro Leadership Group under Franklin Covey focuses on brain only from the context of coaching, what we have done is we have interacted or we have signed off with an organization known as About My Brain Institute, which is based in Australia, which has been working on understanding. So it is actually been run by a neuroscientist. Sylvania is the lady. So they are neuroscientists who run that organization. They go about understanding the latest research in brain science and then start using it to create programs which will help leaders improve their brain towards four ends. The four ends are performance, collaboration, innovation, and agility. So that is what we are doing. So last 10 years, because of the major researches that have taken place in brain science, more and more we are able to understand about the brain. And as we understand more about the brain, we are able to do things that are more likely to succeed. So with that context, let me go to the next slide. And how? Right now, if you see, the world has changed, and how, right? And the world will continue to change. In fact, I think I mentioned this to you also about of Toffler writing this book, Future Shock, where he says the change is going to be so rapid that the human beings are going to be in a state of shock. So we are living in a world where change is happening at that we can't even imagine. So that's the reality of life. If this is the reality of life, we need to relearn how to be a free agent. Who's a free agent? Who can still do things by his own accountability and commitment. In this hugely VUCA world that we are living in, you all would have heard about VUCA, right? So let's just kind of do a little polling here to understand, or let's see what is something that we know about VUCA. So I'm going to share with you. Sorry, I'm going to publish. I'm going to share. So here it is, because it changes dynamics more frequently than ever before. So what is the dash here? Is it volatile? Is it uncertain? Is it complex or ambiguous? Just make your choice. Just quickly make your choice. We'll get to know. Great. Fantastic. Some great inputs coming. Wonderful. Right. Wow. Great. Fantastic. I think a few more, one or two of you are still left. Yeah. Just kind of, you can click on any of the options that you feel is the right option. And let me share the results with you. So this is the result. 50% of us believe this is being volatile. 33% of our believe it is going to be, this means complexity. And yellow is option two. Uncertain is what people are talking about. So the real right answer to this is volatile. So congratulations to who you didn't get right, who got it right. Congratulations, others, it really doesn't matter. So volatility is what we are talking about, where the dynamics of change has become more frequent than before. So with this understanding, let's now understand the other elements of VUCA also. It is that because of its unpredictability. This is easy to guess. This is easy to guess. Yeah. It is easy. So, yeah, it is easier. So I don't know why some people have written volatile, because volatile we have already talked about in the previous one, but it's okay. Yeah, great. Wow. So we've got a rainbow here. Rainbow of colors. Yeah, so exactly, if you see, we have all the colors that they can be possible in this. But the right answer is uncertain. Where we are uncertain, because it's become so unpredictable. So let's also now see the next one. Let's see one more that we can talk about. Okay. It is dash because there are so many variables involved at the same time. Yeah. Absolutely. Fantastic. Some of you are bang on, bang on, bang on. Oh, now this is the first time we have got getting a lot of similar thinking, right? Yeah, we'll talk about it. We'll talk about it. Yeah, so let me end the poll and share with you with the results. So everybody got this, right? It is complex, right? So let's see this. Now, somebody asked, what is the difference between what? So volatile means the world is changing. The change dynamics is so frequent than ever before. So while changes were always happening. So this somebody asked me, Pawan, everybody is saying changes are happening, changes are happening. You read a book which is written in 1980, changes are happening, changes are happening. So why do you say changes are happening even today? So what's different about these changes? The difference about the change that is happening today and will continue to happen in the future is it is getting more and more rapid. Earlier, it may have taken from one generation to another generation of a mobile phone, maybe 2 years. Now, every 3 months, possibly, a new version is coming up. So the rapidity of change is becoming faster and faster and faster. And the human brain has got a limitation. Human brain has got a limitation to be able to change itself so rapidly. So the human brain is under stress. So what we do about it, we'll talk about later. But the fact is, this is what means volatile. What is uncertain? Unpredictable. Right? And what is complex? Because there are so many variables involved at one, nobody can be certain. See, when we make a decision, how many variables can we keep in mind? Whatever we keep in mind, there will be a variable which would be hidden, which we wouldn't even get to know till the time we act on it. I think I mentioned it yesterday, but I'll just go one step deeper. Most of us get an idea in our head. We think about it in our head. We see ourselves acting this out in our head. We see it failing in our head and we do nothing about it in our head. Why is it? Because we aren't certain what would happen. So the only way to live in this world is make a plan, take the variables that you have, act on it, and let and be open to see the emergence of new variables so that as they come, you start fine-tuning your decision or the execution that you're doing. And ambiguous is, there is no clear connection between cause and effect. Earlier, it was simple. You do this, this, and this, you will get these results. Today, that is not so. So the difference between uncertain and ambiguous is, there is too much of randomness. We seem to believe it's the luck factor that is coming. So more and more, the connection between cause and effect is not getting clear. Because of which there is unpredictability. So I would say ambiguity is leading to uncertainty. I think that's the answer to Varun. Because things are ambiguous, they are leading to uncertainty. So if this is what it is, what we are going through, if we do not change, both in terms of a human being and in terms of an organization, we will be a demoralized one. So we have to largely be open to change, and we can change if we understand the science behind the change. I always realize this. In fact, somebody said, after I did a workshop on brain-based learning, somebody said, Pawan, thank you so much. Once I have now understood the brain, I can work on it better. So the more and more you understand the scientific functioning of the brain, the better and better you can manage your brain and look after it, so that it gives optimum performance. Now let's see a little video on evolution of leadership. Okay, so what we are talking about was I4, the answer to the VUCA world. For volatile conditions, we need to have a brain mechanism working, which enables us to think imaginatively. To be uncertain, we need to have inspiration generated within us. And for us to be inspired, we need to have our brain hormones to be generated, which are positive hormones rather than negative hormones like a lot of scientific names. For us to be more complex, to work in a complex environment, we need to have an integrated mind where we should be able to be left brain working, which is logical brain, but we also should be right brain working, which is creativity. So the creativity and logical brain should be talking to each other for us to be able to find answers in this complex condition that we are living in. For the ambiguous world where we don't know what will work, we should be in touch with our intuition. And we'll talk about it later. Our intuition is something that we feel in our stomach, in our heart, because surprisingly, there are brain cells even existing in our gut and even in our heart, in addition to in our brain. So we should be able to know how we can tap into that. So this we'll talk about later. But these I4 models consist of all these biological, neurobiological processes that we know can be improved if we start doing things that can manage to improve them and retain the brain's optimum efficiency. So having done that, we also talked about the three eras, the industrial age, the information age, and the neuroleadership age. See, knowledge is no more power. Why? Because knowledge is available freely. Also, very interestingly, the amount of knowledge that we need today to do the job that we are doing, very little of it we can keep in our brain. In fact, it is assumed that we will get below than 1% at some point in time. So while we need a lot of knowledge in our brain at any point in time, we will be able to keep a minuscule part of it. And hence, no one person would be able to say, I have all the knowledge to find an answer. He will have to interact with others. So the one person knowledge to one person knowledge to one person knowledge. So to a collective percentage of knowledge, if we are able to tap, only then we'll be able to get answers to problems that we are going to face today. Also, the brain, which is a default mechanism in the brain, that if somebody comes to you and you tell him what to do, is not going to work anymore, because the fact is, and humbly so, you do not know what will work. In fact, there's a beautiful word known as Kanban in Japanese, which says, the best idea will come from people with tools in their hands about their job and not by executives sitting in AC offices. So what it really means is, if you had been in a position 5 years before, and if that person comes to you asking for an answer, and if you believe the answer that you're going to give him based on your experience of 5 years hence or earlier, let me tell you, that solution of yours may not be relevant in the present day. So that is why we have moved now beyond the information age, and we have come to something known as imagination age, where a leader should find it okay to say, I don't know. So if I don't know, who knows? Whom can we incorporate? Who can also then interact with us, collaborate with us to find a solution? So we should be more focused on finding out which all people should we get involved in finding an answer to a problem. And where can we then, from which knowledge can we then combine these knowledges to find an answer? Also, one of the most important things today is getting upward feedback, or getting feedback from your peers, or 360 degree feedback, feedback from your team members, and feedback from your managers. We all believe as managers, it is our responsibility, and rightly so, to tell people what they are doing wrong or how can they do it better. But in today's world, it is worthwhile also asking people, can you suggest something to me for me to become better? So that is the imagination age that we talked about. Now, what is the purpose of this workshop? The purpose of the workshop is to learn how you can use the power of your biology to develop your leadership capacity to thrive in the 21st century. Very simple. So understand the biological brain, body, biological functions, which then we can improve to be able to find ourselves doing a better job than what we are doing today. So let's understand the connection between brain and leadership. Okay, so this is brain and leadership. Let's just dwell slightly more on this. So having understood it, let me give you some basics about the brain. So right here, this is the vertebra here, which this comes up here like this. Just connected to the vertebra is our reptilian brain. Now its function is basically to keep us alive. It allows us to breathe. It allows the blood circulation to happen. It allows us to digest food. So all the physical aspects of us that keeps us alive physically happens through the reptilian brain. Now just above this here is our emotional brain. This is the emotional or the limbic brain. This is where emotions reside. And as we evolved as human beings, so this was our initial structure. As we evolved, the brain kept on improving, and as per evolution happened, there was layers and layers of this brain that started getting created, which enabled us to be different from animals, because it enabled us to create something known as the PFC, prefrontal cortex, or the thinking brain. Now, this is a brain which is not available in animals. And what it has been found very interestingly, that over the last so many years of evolution of a human being, while the brain has grown in size 3 times, the prefrontal cortex, that is the thinking brain, has grown in its size by 6 times. So the evolution is allowing us to pass genetically a better brain from a thinking point of view as we go along. So more and more you will find as new generations are coming, their thinking brain is getting better. Unfortunately, these two are not diminishing in size, because this is what we will have every single time. Now, what is important for us to understand the relationship between the thinking brain and the emotional brain. Now, there's a seesaw relationship between our thinking brain and the emotional brain. When the emotions are high, they hijack the capability of the thinking brain to think. How many times, or have any one of us at some point in time done something and later said, my God, what happened to me? Why did I do it? How could I be so stupid? Well, you were not stupid at that point in time, because your emotional brain came up. It shut down the thinking of the thinking brain, and you thereby made a stupid, illogical, unnatural decision at some point in time. Now, what it really means is either the thinking brain can be in power or the emotional brain can be in power. If you are not able to realize that the emotional brain is slowly getting arose, or if the negative emotion is arising, if you are not able to identify that, you will not be able to control this, and thereby at some point in time, you will find you working through your emotions of negativity rather than logical thinking from the thinking. Now, there's a beautiful analogy given to how to handle this. So the analogy is the lion and the lion tamer analogy, which says the lion is the emotional brain. Lion tamer is the thinking brain. Now we understand that in a circus, what does a lion tamer do? What is this guy doing as of now that enables him to keep this lion under control? We may get an answer to what we could do. So anybody can just write down, what do you think this person, the lion tamer, what is he doing in the moment right now? What is he doing? What is he actually focusing on? What is a lion tamer doing at this point in time? They say eye to eye. Right? Wonderful. Trying to control lion emotions, right? So the fact is, you can't control lion's emotions. All that you can do is, and what he's trying to do is, he's trying to identify from the facial expression and the body language of the lion whether the lion is in a state where it will take orders, or is it suddenly getting angry and emotional. And if he finds that he's getting angry or emotional, he will crack the whip or feed him something to get the lion to come down. So from our context, what it really means is we must continuously be able to scan our body to identify any sensation in our body which gives us an indication to a negative emotion that we are feeling. See, our emotions speak to us through sensations in the body. What does it really mean? If I'm angry, you will find some sensations happening. I may have, my heart rate would go up. I may find sweaty palms, right? If I'm nervous, I may have something in the pit of my stomach. So more and more you become aware about your body and the sensations you are feeling at any point in time, you will be able to identify an emotional, or I would say a negative emotional response that you are feeling. And when you are able to identify that, then you go into the next level of being able to control it. So that's the relationship with the PFC, prefrontal cortex, and the emotional brain, and how our thinking brain can keep on noticing the emotions to be able to do something about it. I'm not going to cover various methodologies of doing that, but only trying to understand from the brain point of view why this is so. So with this understanding that we have, let's also understand, they also talked about social brain, right? So our brain has got two different circuits. One is goal-focused circuits, one is social circuits. Now, in the initial part, I think I mentioned this yesterday, but I'm going to go slightly more deeper into this. In the initial part of our lives, we are goal-focused. We need to be goal-focused. We need to be achievement-oriented. And because in the initial parts of our professional life, we are goal-focused and then goal-focused and then goal-focused, we find ourselves using our social circuitry lesser and lesser. Because unfortunately, when you switch on your goal circuitry, you switch off your social circuitry. And because we are focusing so much on our goal circuitry in the initial parts of our careers, that when we reach a stage where we need to be good at our social circuitry, we realize because we have not used it for so long, it has kind of rusted and its effectiveness is reduced. So according to research, less than 5% of leaders are able to use both the networks, that is analytical and social, going at the same time. It can happen, but you need to practice it. And it's completely dependent upon the brain, how well it is functioning. So a few lessons that emerge from this is, a big challenge for business leaders is the circuitry for thinking analytically, switches off the circuit for thinking about others, social circuits. People who spend too much time in only doing analytics and goal focus find themselves having a diminution of social skills. Under pressure, the emotional brain also comes up, and further your social circuitry reduces. The result hence is you have leaders who are only goal focused while they have team members who need to interact with them on a social circuitry basis, and they are not getting that. So what we are trying to say here is it is natural if you are struggling. It is natural if you don't find it easy. Because the fact remains is if you did not focus on your goal circuitry in the initial parts of your career, you wouldn't have reached a manager status where now you need to build up your social circuitry. Having understood this, we need to do a few things to be able to operate our social circuitry. I'll give you, I'll give you 5 things that you must do to enable people under you to feel good about the environment that you're creating. And this is known as the SCARF model. SCARF. Just write down this. So when you interact with people, after a certain point in time, you feel a towards response, a good response towards them, or you want to get away, or an away response. So please keep it in mind that when you interact with your team members and you wear a scarf around you every time, you will be able to create a more enabling and engaging environment. S stands for status. You can write it down. Status. S-T-A-T-U-S. What it means is, when I interact with somebody, I should ensure that I interact with him at a human level and not that you are below me, I'm above you. Because the moment the status of a person gets threatened, if I show you that I know more than you, that I'm better than you, you get into a flight, you get into an emotional response and your thinking brain stop thinking. So one thing that you need to do is status, ensure that you are doing one-to-one conversations, human being to human being, interactive, rather than being too much into the telling mode. So also when you tell people, you put down the status. However, when you ask them, what do you think? You have enhanced the status. C stands for certainty. Certainty is the brain hates uncertainty. So please elaborate when you're wanting to talk to people. What are you wanting to talk about? How much time are you going to spend with them? So that they are certain about what's going to happen. Because the moment people are uncertain, again, emotional response takes place. A stands for autonomy. Everybody loves to have choices in life. Everyone, if you give a situation to a person where he feels he has no choice, again, threat response. So what you do is give them a semblance of autonomy, even if it is perceived autonomy. What do you mean of perceived autonomy? Hey, I want to have a meeting with you. Is 10 or 10:30? What time suits you? 10 or 10:30? It doesn't matter. But he is getting a sense that he has chosen something. If you tell person something that you need, he has to do. Hey, there are three things that you need to do. Can you tell me what priority you like to do it in? Again, you are giving him the autonomy to choose the priority. R stands for relatedness. So when you talk to somebody, talk always about a common goal. What is binding you and me together? Because the brain automatically starts seeing people as either a friend or a foe. If I find some common thing between you and me, I see you as a friend. But if I find there's no commonality, I see you as a foe. That is why team members always find the team as their friend, but the other team members of other teams are the enemies or foes. And F stands for fairness. Please ensure that you not only are fair, but you demonstrate fairness. This comes from the social circuitry part of it. So what we really need today are leadership models like we have always had. But what is important today is to have a leadership model with a brain at the center of it. Everything that you and me do today is a direct function of how well our brain is functioning. If my brain is functioning well, I feel good about myself. When I feel good about myself, my behaviors are demonstrated in a manner that people around us also feel good about themselves. That is why brain has to be the center of any leadership model, because it has been found through huge amount of research that the best of the best of the best leaders have brains which seem to be evolved brains, optimized brains. And that is what this neuroleadership model actually will give us. So the I4 neuroleadership model was developed in 2013, a model that incorporates the latest advancements from neuroscience to understand a leader's brain and subsequent behavior. Now, there are four elements that we want to focus on. That is performance. How does my brain act in a particular way that I can be high performing? How does my social brain act in a particular way that I can be collaborative? How can my creative brain act in a way that I can be innovative? And how can I balance my emotional brain, especially when there's unambiguity or there's ambiguity around me, to be agile and to be able to still be logical when there are threats, perceived threats around me. So these are four competencies that we talk about. Each one of them is connected to one of the pillars of a neurobiological change. So for performance, for us to be great performers, our brain needs to work in an integrated manner. So we have various functions of our brain. We have the PFC, we have the social brain, we have the creative brain. So each part of the brain should be working in cohesion with each other for us to be able to perform better. Let me show you a little video on integration, and then we'll move forward. Let's just see a little, do a little polling to find out how well are we integrated. Just answer this question. One is very poor, five is very good, others are in between. Great. So as I said, I won't get to know who's writing what. I'll only get a percentage, and so will you. So great. A lot of great input from all of you. I think there's one person or two people who have left, who haven't taken the poll. Yeah, there it comes. So this is where we are today. This also shows us how integrated our mind is. Integration of mind is like the brain working in a beautiful symphony. Also, you can write down three things that you could do to have a better integrated mind. The first is, get feedback from people around you as to how do they see you performing. Get feedback from people around you, and in the feedback you can just ask them, what are one or two behaviors that you want, that you see in me, that you want to improve? See, unfortunately, we are not very good judges of our own behavior. I judge myself based on my intention. But people judge me based on my behavior. So more often than not, when you do a self-assessment of yours, or all of us, we normally assess ourselves based on what I intention, what we think we intend to do. But many a times, there's a gap between our intention as our demonstrated behavior. And that is why it's better to get feedback from team members. In fact, with some organizations, we do this. We ask every team member to write down for each other, and each one then shares with others one or two behaviors he's going to improve for the next 1 month, and then they take again a feedback from each other. So that's one way for you to have a better integrated mind. The second way is to deeply breathe. The second is to breathe deeply. Whenever you're breathing, just put your hand on your stomach right now. Always have abdomen breathing. If you find yourself getting emotionally nervous and stressful, you will find that you're breathing from your chest. On the other hand, if you start breathing from your stomach, you'll find yourself slowly getting down your stress levels. So learn to breathe deeply and through the abdomen as much as you can. The third thing that you need to do is identify your emotional reactions in situations where you do not act in a manner that you like yourself to act. So identify situations where your emotions tend to take control and assess those emotions as to why they are happening. Again, in this short period, I'll not be able to give you an answer to this, but that's an important part too. Okay, now let's go to the next part, which is inspiration. So in collaboration, I can only collaborate with you if I inspire you. You like to work with me only if you feel excited about it, right? So inspiration refers to the energy, enthusiasm, and desire to act as a result of feeling mentally and emotionally stimulated. So you must know how to firstly inspire yourself. Not easy, but required. Because as you start inspiring yourself, people around you through something known as a mirror neuron, you heard about that in the brain science, by mirror neurons will start mirroring your emotions and your behavior. So if you're excited, people around you will also get excited. And inspiration is truly the fuel of human existence. If I don't get inspired, my fuel will get, I won't have the fuel to really do things I want. And you can do three things to be able to be inspired. Create a vision board for yourself. Create a board where you write down or put or stick pictures about what do you really want to achieve. What is your vision about your life? In fact, with organization, we ask people to make goal boards. So ask your team to identify the team goals and make a team board with the goals being written in that in a very interesting way. So create a vision board for yourself or a team vision board for your team and ensure you look at it a couple of times every day. Second is develop a habit of complimenting others. There's a man, there's a team member who said, I don't know what's wrong with me. Every time I make a mistake, my manager seems to notice it. So more often than not, we have been taught to identify and point out mistakes of people, but each one that we know of is doing something good as well. So start complimenting them for that. The third is volunteer for a good cause. Do something good for others without getting anything in return. That's the way you could inspire yourself. The next is imagination. Imagination is all about coming up with new ideas, creativity, the inside aha moments. So again, this is a brain function. And to get better at that, you should be able to, what is imagination? Imagination is able to see something that isn't there already. So to be able to do that, please from next time onwards, if there's a problem, don't imagine that the first solution that you have got is the best solution. Identify three alternate solutions. Most of us, we choose the first best solution that we get, or so we presume. We don't delve deeper into that. So what you need to do is identify three alternate solutions that will help you imagine something that you would normally not imagine. So it will help you go deeper into your own creativity to come out with something that would not initially come at the surface of your thinking. Secondly, learn to relax. See, the PFC, prefrontal cortex, whenever you do something which is requiring concentration, this PFC of ours starts sucking glucose from our blood. And its effectiveness, because it lacks glucose, it needs a lot of glucose to work well. After around 2 odd hours, it loses its capacity to work effectively. So after every 2 hours of concentrated work, take some time off to go and do something which will ease you, which will relax you. It could be interaction with somebody. It could be going and having a cup of water or glass of water, talking to somebody, joking around with somebody. So have small bits of peace time in your life, in your day-to-day life, where you really focus on relaxing yourself. That's another way you could. That will help your imagination. And the third and a very, very important thing is keep a diary with you, where you can write down new ideas that come in your mind. Because the fact is, you will get your best idea about a problem when you are not thinking about the problem. So if you keep a little diary, each one of us has some wonderful ideas coming to our brain at times when we don't even imagine they would come. While taking a bath, while driving to office, while doing nothing but going for a walk. That's the time our good ideas come. But the bad news is, while these good ideas come at a time when your brain is relaxed, and they do come, they also tend to disappear and do not get into your short-term or long-term memory if you do not write it down. So they come and they dissolve. So that's another way is keeping a diary with you. The fourth element that we talked about is intuition. Tapping into something. So intuition is nothing but recognizing what is invisible. So don't think everything about the brain. Also think about it from a heart. What does my heart say? What is my gut feel? Ask yourself questions about like this. What is my gut feel about this? What is my heart saying? So rather than not only using your logical brain, ask yourself questions like the one I told you. Also, practice mindful meditation if you can. In fact, I'm also a practitioner of mindful meditation. And that is something that you could pick up from somewhere for certain period of time on a daily basis. Meditate. And take your hunches into account. Just a few things, tips I've given you. Now, in the IFO model that we have, performance has got four elements of the brain that needs to work. While we talked about integration, it is also balance, it is also ethics, it is also mental readiness. For us to be collaborative, other than be inspiring, we need to have the brain communicating well, generosity, and courage. We need to have all these elements. So there are 16 pillars that we work on to get a more optimized brain. And in innovation, it is imagination, it is drive, it is curiosity. When we say, identify at least three alternate solutions to a problem, that is curiosity. And attitude of being playful or trying to find some new ideas, right? And relaxing, doing something which gives you a time away from work. So these are the elements that you need to work on. Also for agility, you need intuition, you need awareness, you need influence, and you need adaptability. So the entire IFO model has got 16 pillars that we work on based on the need of people, of course, because there's an assessment also which we believe people need to do. And this is the outcome of what would happen if you're able to optimize your brain to perform, collaborate, innovate, and adapt. You'll be present. Have good judgments. All of this is given here. I'm not going to repeat it. Any questions anybody has, let's go to that. The last thing I'll just like to tell you and finish off by saying, to lead better, we need to be in the highest health of mental fitness and body fitness. So our mind, body, and brain, all three should be working at the optimum level for us to have a sustainable life and a happy life. Summary points, our brain is involved in everything we do. When it works well, we feel good and we even look better. There's a glow in our face. The brain is one of the most complex organs that you've seen. It does so many things. We have just only got to the tip of what it does, but there's much more that you'll get to know. Our brain is extremely delicate. It gets affected, hugely affected by lack of sleep, continuous stress, alcohol abuse, a lot of things that we do and we imagine it doesn't affect our brain, it does affect our brain. If you don't play, if you don't have exercise, your brain deteriorates. Please remember, a large percentage of our brain cells are dying every day, every single day. There's only one way to regenerate them, and that one way is exercise. It has been documented to say people who do not regularly exercise in the age group of 40 to 50 will in their old age after 65 have Alzheimer's, loss of memory, a lot of brain diseases. So exercise is a fundamental part of it. Our brain has limited resources. We found this PFC. This is just 4% of our entire brain. Our prefrontal cortex, which is our thinking brain, is only 4%. Limited resource. Hence, we need to be able to use it in the right manner and also rest it so that it can keep regenerating itself before you put it to use. So we are not going to use a marathon's model. Marathoner's model is what? Keep running, keep running, keep running, keep running. A sprinter's model is more effective. Sprint, relax. Sprint, relax. So all the top players in the world, between the intense time that they are doing extreme exercise and activity, they are also having periods of rest in between. That is also true for our own brain. Specific parts of the brain are associated with certain behavior. We talked about it. The social brain, the goal-focused brain, the VFC, the emotional brain. We are all unique. So we have 60 strategies to work on. All of them will not work with each one of us. And even if we try, we can't. So you and me need to take, I've shared three each with you. We need to take one of those activities and start implementing that. the brain, and therefore the body can change and improve. That's the good news that we have. That brings me to the end of this. I'm 7 minutes late. I'm sorry for that. If there's any question, I would love to take it. Any one or two questions, if you have, you can just type them up and we can try to answer them. This is very helpful. No question. Thank you so much. Could you please kind enough to just write your comments on how useful you found this? I had a very good time with all of you. And I'm so grateful to each one of you to take time off your busy schedule. And even being home, you have taken time to log in. And thank you for all of you. It's been amazing interacting with you. Looking forward to many, many such beautiful things ahead. Thank you. Look after yourself. Be safe, be healthy, and be brain fit. Thank you. Have a great time. Bye-bye.